Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 22nd November 2018. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these five. First one is about the Sentinelese tribes of Andaman and Nicobar Island. The second article talks about the governor's rule in the state of Jammu Kashmir. Third one is about the plastic pollution. And the fourth one is about World Trade Organization. And the final article talks about Central Bureau of Investigation. The first article we'll be seeing is Sentinel Tribe on Restricted Andaman Island. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So this article was in news because a recently American citizen was reportedly killed by the Sentinels group in the Andaman Nicobar Island. So we have to know what these Sentinels tribals are. So before that, let's see broadly the number of tribal groups existing in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. In Andaman Island alone, there are four aboriginal tribal groups, and in Nicobar, there are two aboriginal tribal groups. So in Andaman, the four groups are, number one is the Great Andamanese, second one is Ongase, third tribal group is Jarawas, and the final one are Sentinelese. So mostly all these four tribal groups, they practice nomadism. And out of these four, the group called the Sentinelese, they are most hostile to outsiders. Their source of contact to outside group is very limited, and they completely follow isolation policy. And in Nicobar Island, there are two major tribal groups. Number one is Champans. And second tribal group is Nicobarese. And one distinguishing feature about this Nicobarese group is they are the only tribal group in the Andaman and Nicobar Island following practicing agriculture as their major economic activity. And these two tribal groups from Nicobar, they are from another race called as Mongoloid race. That is, their descendants, they trace back to Malay and Burma Peninsula. So coming back to Sentinelese group, they belong to Negrito tribe, and they are highly hostile to the excluders, and they are living in the North Sentinel Island of Andaman Nicobar, located here. And according to census 2001, their population is very, very limited, counting only 39 inhabitants in North Sentinelese Island. How are these tribal communities protected according to Indian constitution? So how are these tribal groups protected as per India? So we have a separate law called as Andaman Nicobar Protection of Aboriginal Tribes Regulation 1956 in order to protect their diversity in India. So according to these regulation, traditional areas occupied by these aboriginal tribes are considered as separate reserves, and they are completely excluded from the touch of the outsiders. There's also prohibition of entry of people without any authorization into these reserves. And activities such as filming the tribes and even photographing the tribes are considered as offense, and there are severe penalty imposed for those activities. And this map, it shows the area of extent occupied by the tribes of Andaman Nicobar Island. Here is North Sentinel Island, where the Sentinelese tribes live, and Ongay Island occupied by the Ongay tribal group, and Jarawas occupying Jarawa group. And these two maps, they compare the shrinkage of area occupied by the tribal groups, which is an area of grave concern, as diversity of this tribal groups are under severe threat. The next article we'll be seeing is Fight Against Plastic Pollution to Get Tougher. So this article was taken from the newspaper Indian Express. So this article, it begins with a list of facts showing the extent of plastic pollution in our country. So recognizing the importance of the plastic pollution, even UNEP has based its World Environment Day's theme as Beat Plastic Pollution. So every day in India, about 15,000 tons of plastic is generated, and out of the generated plastic, only minimal amount of plastic is disposed safely and recycled. Less of the plastic is left unprocessed into various bodies, including the marine bodies. And out of the emitted plastics, 90 to 95% of them, they come from informal sector in our country. And according to sources of Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, about 35% of the plastic is consumed by the packaging industry, followed by building and construction, so electronics, followed by agriculture. On comparing with other global countries, India's per capita consumption of plastic is much, much lower than the global average when compared to other developed countries such as US and even developing countries such as China and Brazil. However, taking into consideration the increasing environmental pollution, India must definitely take into consideration the harmful effects caused by the plastic pollution and also work on reducing the usage of plastics with other eco-friendly alternatives such as jute. The next article we'll be seeing is, amid contrasting claims, Jammu Kashmir governor dissolves the assembly. So in the month of June, governor's rule was imposed in the state of Jammu Kashmir. And this imposition of governor's rule was as per Section 92 of Constitution of Jammu Kashmir. So according to Section 92 of Constitution of Jammu Kashmir, the governor's rule can be imposed by the governor of Jammu Kashmir after having consent from the president of India. And the period of imposition of the governor's rule can only be for 6 months. And during this 6 months, the Constituent Assembly of Jammu Kashmir can either be suspended or it can even be dissolved. And till now, the State Assembly of Jammu Kashmir has been suspended by the governor. And now, recently, the governor of Jammu Kashmir has dissolved the assembly due to failure of constitutional machinery of the state of Jammu Kashmir. So another provision is that if the constitutional machinery is not restored up to the period of 6 months, then Article 356 of Indian Constitution, that is, which says about precedent rule, can be imposed by the governor of Jammu Kashmir. And the governor of Jammu Kashmir has stated the following reasons for dissolving the assembly of Jammu Kashmir. Number one is impossibility of forming a stable government in the state of Jammu Kashmir, extensive horse trading, lack of clear-cut majority, and even the security reasons and the fragile scenario existing in the state of Jammu Kashmir. The next article we'll be seeing is WTO panel to review US steel aluminium tariffs. We all know about the ongoing tariff wars. So this tariff was mainly between USA and China. So the WTO's dispute settlement body has now agreed to establish a separate panel to review the legality of retaliatory tariff imposed by USA. So we'll see a bit about the dispute settlement body of WTO. So this is a 7-member appellate body. Mainly constituted for resolving the trade disputes between the member countries of WTO. So resolving trade disputes is one of the main mechanisms to maintain equilibrium in multilateral world order. And the World Trade Organization's dispute settlement body is one such body which preserves such equilibrium. So the recently constituted panel of experts to review the action of US on countries like China, Canada and EU is especially important when the various countries go forward practicing protectionist policies going against the principles of multilateral global order. The next article we'll be seeing is limits of CBI jurisdiction. This article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So this article broadly talks about the extent of jurisdiction of Central Bureau of Investigation. So we all know CBI is a national agency with police powers. So it was established under Delhi Special Police Establishment Act of 1963. And this CBI is also India's premier nodal agency to cooperate with Interpol. Though the primary jurisdiction area of CBI is restricted to Delhi and Union Territories, various other states of India can also exercise the powers of CBI with the consent of the states. So, however, some states can even opt out of the purview of CBI. Example, Andhra Pradesh and West Bengal have withdrawn their general concern for the CBI to operate within their territories. So this provision is clarified in Section 5 and Section 6 of CBI Act clearly. So according to Section 5 of the Act, the central government can extend the provisions of CBI to all the states. However, according to Section 6, the extension of powers of CBI to the states can only happen with the consent of the government of each and every state. So this question of jurisdiction of CBI was also addressed by Supreme Court in Kazi Lendub Dorji case in the year 1994, according to specific individual cases also. However, when a case is allocated to CBI, withdrawal cannot happen in between unless the case reaches its logical conclusion. The topics we'll be seeing for mains are these four. First one is about manual scavenging and their rehabilitation. Second is about Odisha's recently passed Land Rights Act. Third article talks about the job growth data across India's various sectors. Fourth article is about making commodity options for farmers. The first article we'll be seeing is about manual scavenging and their rehabilitation. And this article was taken from the newspaper Indian Express. So what is manual scavenging? Manual scavenger is a person who is engaged to manually clean, carry, or even dispose in any manner human excreta that is not decomposed. So in India, manual scavengers, they formed a community who are among the most poorest and even disadvantaged groups in India. And despite even technological achievements and increasing human rights issues, manual scavenging continues to persist in India. And manual scavenging goes directly against the constitutional provisions of 15, 21, 17, 38 and 42 of Indian Constitution. And even Gandhi and Ambedkar, they were both great propenders of elimination of this evil practice which still persists in India. So what are the main reasons for manual scavenging in India? So the main, one of the major reasons is because of the existing continued presence of insanitary latrines. And this issue of manual scavenging is strongly connected to caste system in India. So as it is linked to the caste system in India, the victims of manual scavenging, they are subjected to severe violence, untouchability and even discrimination in their day-to-day life. So first, in the year 1993, Employment of Manual Scavenging and Construction of Dry Latrines Act, which was the first landmark judgment to outlaw unsanitary latrines, was brought into force. However, because of lack of political, economic and even social assertive voice, the community remained to be neglected, and because of which in the year 2013, another act was passed called as Prohibition of Employment of Manual Scavengers and a Rehabilitation Act. So this act seeks to reinforce the ban of prohibiting manual scavenging in all forms. So the government even set up National Commission for Safai Karamcharis. To safeguard their interest of manual scavengers. So in order to empower and economically uplift the manual scavengers, National Safai Karamcharis Finance and Development Commission was constituted in the year 1997. The major aim of this commission is to uplift the Safai Karamcharis by providing them with alternative skill set, thereby providing them alternative source of employment. Only when there is alternative source of employment to empower the Safai Karamcharis, they can quit their only source of employment, that is via manual scavenging. By economically uplifting the manual scavengers, it can translate into social upliftment too, thereby providing a path for establishing egalitarian India. So according to socio-economic caste census in India, at least one member of about 2 lakh households in rural India are employed in manual scavenging. And according to census of 2011, in 7,40,000 households, human excreta is removed directly by human beings. So the government has even brought in various schemes to eliminate manual scavenging. So according to Rashtriya Garima Abhiyan, which is a national campaign to eradicate manual scavenging and thereby bringing in dignity to the lives of the people who are employed in manual scavenging, government plans to establish a discrimination-free, secure and even alternative livelihood to the people employed in manual scavenging. In order to rehabilitate the manual scavengers by Rashtriya Garima Abhiyan, first one needs to identify the manual scavengers. According to census 2011, just 7% of households engaged in manual scavenging are actually identified by the census. Just 93% of the manual scavengers are left unidentified, which is a grave area of concern. So this Rashtriya Garima Abhiyan, it aims to rectify this problem by identifying the manual scavengers, thereby rehabilitating them. So allowing one individual to carry the excreta of another individual, it definitely goes against the principle of civility of humanity. In order to comprehensively include manual scavengers into the mainstream Indian society, the government must provide them with proper education, which will translate into economic as well as social empowerment of the excluded group. The next article we'll be seeing is Odisha Land Rights Act, Technology for All. So this article majorly talks about a technological perspective involved in Odisha Land Rights Act. So before getting into the technological perspective, we need to know what the act is about. So via this Odisha Land Rights to Slum Dwellers Act of 2017, the government of Odisha plans to give over 2 lakh households the land rights. By providing them with land rights, it aims to provide them with livable habitats, thereby providing them with good facilities for sanitation, housing, education, credit facilities, thereby providing them with better standard of living. In order to achieve the mission of this Odisha Land Rights to Slum Dwellers Act, it uses technology as a major tool. It uses drones as a major tool for geospatial mapping, thereby providing aerial images of the slums. By using drums, aerial images of the slum areas will be collected and mapped to efficiently provide land rights to the slum dwellers. In order to efficiently rehabilitate the slum dwellers, data is important. However, in case of slums, not just in Odisha but all over the India, there is lack of proper availability of data. Instead of going and manually collecting the data, usage of drones using technology to collect the data from the slums increases the efficiency of the whole process. Slums all over India is mapped by informal settlements. So in order to document these informal settlements, drones can be used. And this mapping is a first step towards providing land rights to these informal settlers in India. And the verification of the drone data at the first level can be done by non-governmental organization too. So thus technology can be an important tool to bring in inclusiveness in India. Technology is also a very important tool to bring in social change. The whole process of using technology to bring in social change can also help India achieve the sustainable development goal of 10 of establishing inclusive and sustainable habitat. The next article we'll be seeing is, government may report jobs growth data across all sectors by early 2019. This article was also taken from the newspaper Mint. Many labor economists across the world, they term India's economic growth as jobless growth. They consider it so because of India's jump from primary sector, that is agricultural sector, to directly tertiary service oriented sector, completely neglecting the secondary manufacturing sector. So using EPFO as well as GST data, the economic survey of 2018 has shown increasing formalization of Indian economy. However, this claim of Indian government has been disputed by many labor economists. So in order to ascertain the claim of the government has decided to go forward and collect the growth data across all sectors by early 2018. This new data, which will be unveiled by central government, will consist of series of employment generation data collected from both industries as well as households. Currently, the data collection by the government comes from two major sources, that is EPFO data as well as Labor Bureau's data. Both of these data, they have their own limitations. For example, EPFO's data, both of these data suffer from duplication issues. And because of this, we don't get a comprehensive real picture of Indian economy. The final article we'll be seeing is, making commodity options work for farmers. So Indian farmers, they suffer from multiple problems from multiple sides. Their over-dependence on monsoon, lack of agricultural infrastructures including irrigation, issues in market penetration, lack of access to latest technology, all these creates a vicious cycle which pushes them into poverty. These factors also makes the lives of the farmers highly volatile. So in order to address the problem of volatility, one solution is introducing option trading instruments for farmers. What are options? So options are basically forms of derivatives, which means they derive their price from the underlying commodity, which is the agricultural commodities here. So options are basically agreement or contracts between the buyers and sellers to sell their produce at certain prices. And it can be broadly classified into two types. And there are broadly two types of options, that is call options and put options. If the buyer exercises the right to buy, then it's called as call option. Or if the seller exercises his right to sell, it's called as put option. And by using this options trading, farmers can be effectively hedged from the issues of volatility. Thus, this options trading will increase the market penetration of farmers as it uses technology as a tool to increase their buyer demography, thereby providing them with enough source of livelihood, which will in turn help them to come out of the vicious cycle of poverty. So it is to be noted that this future trading option was launched in the year 2003 at national level commodity exchanges. So by using this, farmers can foresee the trend of prices of the commodities and produce the commodities accordingly. And take appropriate decisions in various cropping seasons. Thank you.